Hello and welcome to Operations Management. So for many of you, this is the first time you've been exposed to these types of topics. So I'm excited today to kind of share with you kind of an overview about kind of what we're doing in class and the different types of topics we're going to discuss. It's going to be quite an interesting class. There's a lot of fun stuff to get through. I'm hoping that you're going to learn tons in this class, trust me. There's going to be everything from some mathematics and things like that, so kind of brush up on your algebra. Again, you want to get your Excel skills up to par, so if you want to get those kind of going, we're going to be going through a lot of spreadsheet type operations and different models using that. But for now, let's just focus on an introduction about what operations management is and how it actually affects businesses today. And this is, I've kind of updated the information a little bit from what the textbook has, because there's been changes in a lot of these models. So first off, let's talk about operations management as far as what the definition of operations management is. So when you think about operations management as a business function, you're really in charge of a lot of the things that make up what we call operations. That's everything from planning, coordinating, controls, resources, producing products, technology, services, all those types of things have to be managed somehow. Marketing doesn't do those types of things. Finance helps finance a lot of those things, but they're not directly in control of that. HR is not directly in control of all of that. And unless the CEO is an operations person, sometimes they will have an actual operations person take care of these things. So what are some different characteristics of that? It is definitely a management and leadership function because you have to be able to make leadership decisions on a day-to-day basis. It's really the core of any type of operation, particularly when you're dealing with products or services, which almost every organization does. And it doesn't matter if you're a small, large, medium-sized company, whether you're in service, whether you're a profit or nonprofit, there are always operations that have to be handled. So let's take a look at a little bit more of a focus into our areas like tech organizations, which is something we're keenly interested in. So as you would imagine, you typically have something like a president or a CEO function that kind of oversees not only what's going on in the company, but they also do the interfacing between all the investors or any other types of operations like that. Underneath that is where you're going to find different types of operations. It can be, and here we see it as kind of like a COO, chief operating officer, is if it's an executive level, or VP of operations if they do the VP structure. Again, you're managing people, equipment, technologies, materials, information, products, goods, or services. So when you really think about it, that's a lot. Then there's the other types of leadership for different things. So for marketing, you're really doing a lot of the interactions between customers, demands, how are our sales and goods meeting the needs. CFO or VP of finance really is on the money side. So they're trying to manage cash flow. What are their assets? How are their capital investments? So capital that's sitting on the side and they want to gain some interest, say, or doing some things, or having capital outlays and planning those out. The other type of thing that they don't talk about, which I added to this, which is not in the textbook, is also like chief technology officers. Now, in a tech company, technology is at one of the cores. So you have to have people with the technical knowledge to understand how this stuff works, how are we going to build it, how are we going to design it, what's coming, what's the future, you know, where is the market going to. Could have a lot of different names. It could be a chief technology officer, chief science officer I've seen, chief information officer if it's more of an information-based technology company that could be services-based on information, VP of engineering if it's engineering heavy. So these are different types of things, and there's some crossover here between operations. As you can see, there's equipment, materials, information, innovation, all sorts of things that can be on that. And that's really specific to tech organizations, which you're seeing more and more of that because there's a blending of tech and regular organizations. So kind of focusing back on OM or operations management, really what you're doing in this type of role is you're in charge of transforming resources into products, goods, or services. And so this is kind of like a little diagram of that. So you've got people, you've got materials, perhaps you have technology or an information technology, And you're innovating by creating processes that will transform all these resources into whatever it is that we want, whether maybe we're making cars, or maybe we're making a internet service, or we're making, you know, the next mobile cell phone or something like that. Whatever it is, this transformation of how do you turn these resources into products or services is what operations management is all about. And of course, you're generating value, hopefully, through this process. And it doesn't happen in a vacuum, because how we designate what we're going to do with these resources has to come ultimately from feedback from the customer, and also performance feedback from the marketplace on how do we stack up against competitors and performance. So all those things are kind of important when you're trying to look at those types of things. So in this transformation role, again, and I mentioned it earlier, we need to add value. Now, what does that mean? That means that we come in with a certain set of resources that have a cost associated with them, whether it's materials, what have you. And we're through the transformational process, whatever the value is of the cost there, the value on the back end, particularly for for-profits, has to be higher. Why? Well, it's a for-profit. So you have to then sell the products and or services at a higher value than what it was for you to do this transformation process and those initial cost of resources. In that regard, you're adding value. So you're increasing a product value at every stage of the transformation. This is how you get enough margin to both cover your costs and hopefully get some profits out of it. So sustainability, the minimal part of sustainability, is getting right to where your revenues meet your costs. That's where you hit that point of break even. Now, even for just a sustainable, even if it's for a nonprofit, that's hard to sustain that way, because you want to have a little extra. You usually need a buffer. So sustainability targets just above that, whereas when you're trying to maximize profitability, you try to stretch that even above and beyond there to get enough of a margin so that you have profits in excess. So that's kind of what adding value does for you. It also provides the other aspect is not just adding value, it's also getting an efficient transformation. So if you're doing a transformation, that's great, but if it costs you more than the customer is willing to pay, then you're not going to survive. You're not going to be very efficient. So usually trying to minimize the cost to get to that transformation to where you have a product or service that the customer actually wants, that's where you have to make sure that you're doing it efficiently enough to do that. And that's really what the operations managers are constantly looking at doing. So, and it's a little bit different. It's different between a service company or a manufacturer, which makes products or goods. So how's it different? Well, let's take a look. In a services company, we're really talking about something that's kind of intangible. Product can't be inventoried. So it's not something that you can stock up on in case you have more orders than you, or you think that you have. You have a lot of customer contact. So there's a lot of back and forth between the customers. And usually the response time is very quick. It's very labor intensive. Most consulting companies fall under these types of services. So you can imagine that's quite a bit different, and it's pretty cost intensive and linear usually by the number of people performing services. Counter that with manufacturers, where it's a product-based company. You have physical products. Yes, you can inventory these, so you could make a whole bunch of widgets, let's say 1,000 widgets, and you think you're ordering maybe 800-900, but you can have a buffer in case you have a surge or something like that. Lower customer contact, however, these days there's a lot more expectation there. Depends upon the type of product, of course. Longer response time, and these are usually capital intensive because you have to pay for tooling, you got to set up operations, you got to set up manufacturing. If you don't do it in-house, you got to set it up somewhere else. So what's common between these two? Well, they all use technology these days. You can't get away from that. I challenge you to find a really successful business today that doesn't have a website and isn't maintaining that type of process and nor emails. And so you're going to have to use those types of things to be able to communicate with customers. You have to have quality and productivity controls, and you have to be able to respond to issues when things go awry, and they will go awry, trust me. You need to be able to forecast demand. You have to understand what your capacity is. What can you crank out versus what your demand is? You want to make sure that those things are as matched as well as possible, and your capacity is a little bit in excess of your demand. What's your layout? Where are you located at? Where's an efficient location? You hear about companies always looking for their new locations and how they have bidding to figure out where those are going to be, particularly if they're big companies. Have customer suppliers and scheduling and staffing issues. All these types of things come in that process. However, most things are hybrids, really, when you look at it now, because even products now have some services that can go with products. So let's say you have a product that is a software-hardware combination. So a phone is a great example of that. There's hardware, there's expectations that it will start up, that the battery won't die, all these kinds of things on the hardware end. Yet there's the service side, because now you have your phone that also is a service. So you're wanting to make phone calls. You want to make sure that your data is connecting. All sorts of things that can go along with that. So you really have both sides in these types of businesses where you have to have service and manufacturing go hand in hand. Okay, so and what we've been seeing steadily for years now, this only goes up to 2014. I was trying to look for new data. However, what happened after 2014, U.S. Department of Commerce started changing their stats a little bit. So it isn't quite presented in this way anymore. So we have to come up with a different way of looking at how to present this. But this was looking at percentage of workforce in service producing organizations versus goods producing organizations. And you can see this divergence here, where service producing companies has gone way up as a percentage of workforce. What's interesting is now, when you look at a lot of companies that are really hybrids, it isn't necessarily one way or the other. It's a little bit of both. So when we have strategies that we make from an OM standpoint, those strategies are our long-term thinking, and they're going to direct what type of tactical decisions that we make to make those strategies happen. So if you think about it as like there's the plan and then there's the actions that are going to make the plan happen. A little bit like that. So typically we look at strategic decisions as long-term, broad in scope. That's something to direct the entire company, usually towards some type of vision. A tactical decision is a little bit different. It's more narrow in scope, short-term, focuses specifically on anything from the day-to-day. It could be resources we need. What are the schedules that we need to adjust? How much do we need to produce? All those kinds of things. Okay, so let's step back a bit and let's kind of think about where did OM kind of come from? Where is this whole process coming from? And why do companies do a lot of things that they do now? This is where we kind of have to take a little bit of historical context, coming back to where did things begin and why do we do some of the things we do? Early on, if we go back to the 1700s, and this is by far, this is just a quick overview in two slides, so it's very quick. In the Industrial Revolution, we added machines to human power. So it wasn't just people making things. It was now people in combination with machines making things. Now, of course, they were pretty basic steam machines, very low-end mechanical, no intelligence at all, run by people. But that was the beginning of what we'd call today automation, which we don't have back then. It was really, you automated just a very minimal task. The machine did it over and over again. Scientific management came around after that. This is where we started using scientific method, just like we do in other sciences, and applied them to business. So we could figure out how do assembly lines work? How can we make it more efficient? What are things we can do when we need to make mass production? You see a lot of that with examples like with Ford. Human relations movement. So people got sick of being run by the barons, and you know, when the Great Depression hit, all those types of things, they started realizing that you got to take care of the worker, the employees. And I have to say, America has kind of gotten a little lost on that again. We're a little bit behind the times as to some other places as far as human relations, because they realized that worker motivation, job satisfaction, matters. It matters as to how productive they are. It matters to keep a balance within the community because people are not machines and you can't treat them the same. Management science comes online really 40s to 60s. This is where we're taking that analysis from the scientific management and now moving it into quantitative techniques to really measure what we're doing. Computer age starts in the 1960s, really didn't hit big in companies, not until later, until 70s, 80s, and really 90s when things took off. Environmental issues, hot topic in the 70s. How do we deal with all this waste? How do we recycle? How do we reuse? All those types of things. Just in time, that becomes something. Total quality management, we'll talk a little bit more about that. And it keeps going on and on. Re-engineering in the 80s, global competition, flexibility. All of these topics are going to be things we're going to be hitting on later. So make sure that you kind of go through these just to get a cursory understanding at this point. We're going to go into a lot of these into more detail, some of them with our own chapters later on. So just to highlight some of the big ones, scientific management, it's an approach to management. So we're trying to focus on improving output. How do we redesign jobs so that they're easier to do and you could get more per person? That's where productivity comes from. How do we determine what the acceptable levels of worker output are that are appropriate? This was really promoted by Frederick Taylor, popularized by Henry Ford, and you can read through a lot of those types of things in the book. Human relations management. So this is what we were talking about later on. So they did a series of studies called the Hawthorne Studies. This is where we really started to discover that human relations was really important with workers' needs and what did they need, because they've got families, they've got other obligations other than just being there for the job. And this was at Western Electric Company way back when in the 30s. Human relations movement also looked at things like job enlargement and job enhancement. So job enlargement is really where giving you larger portion of total tasks to do. Why? Because if you just delegate somebody to doing one task all the time, can they do it? Yeah. But do they want to stay doing that forever? No. You'll get a lot of people that will get leave the job because they're not happy at it and they're miserable, they're not growing. Because one of the things they find is people need to grow. They want to learn. They want to get more responsibility oftentimes, particularly if they want to get to leadership positions. Job enrichment is a little bit of that as well, but it's a greater role in planning in how the job works and also giving feedback on improvements on how they can improve whatever the job is or the work environment that they're in. Management science takes a little bit different direction, focusing on development of quantitative techniques. So now we're using math and stats to solve operation problems. Example with this is linear programming. That's a little bit further along. And how do we use statistical optimization of productivity? We'll talk about this stuff more as we get into the class. Just in time, it's another philosophy that also came in. Designed to achieve high volume production by eliminating waste and continuous improvement. We'll talk about this much more in detail later on, but that's just in a nutshell what it is. That goes hand in hand with something called total quality management. It's a philosophy that seeks to improve quality by eliminating causes of product defects and making the quality the responsibility of everybody in the organization. So it matters because quality costs you much more on the back end if your product is out to market than it does on the front end. And trust me, I've seen this live where when you have products that go out and they don't do well or there's some type of failure or something, think of the recalls that auto companies have had to do when something goes out and there's a malfunction, particularly when there's risk involved with human lives. So ISO 9000 is a global set of standards. It helps with a lot of companies trying to make sure that they're meeting certain standards for obtaining certain types of contracts as far as their quality is concerned. And there's a whole bunch of other types of things. I like to call them, and this isn't what they call them in the book, but it's called competitive operations optimization of processes, and what are the strategies that they do. So there's four that they mention here. They're not the only ones, but re-engineering is one particular one. It's redesigning company process to make them more efficient. There's flexibility, which is an organizational strategy, which a company attempts to offer a greater variety, different types of product choices for different customers. So that's a different strategy to be competitive in the marketplace. Another way to try to differentiate yourself and make yourself competitive is try to do mass customization. Not always easy to do in certain markets, so it really depends if it's the right fit. But it is the ability for being able to make highly customizable goods and services and do them in high volumes. Again, that's a different tough nut to crack. And then the other one that you've seen a lot of, and groups like FedEx or Amazon really focus a lot on this, is time-based competition. It's an organizational strategy focused on developing products and delivering them faster than others. Supply chain management. We're going to have a whole chapter on supply chain management. What we're essentially talking about there is the flow of materials from the suppliers through your organization, through either manufacturing process or service transformation process to the customers. Typically, supply chain management is really heavy in manufacturing. It can be heavy in service organizations. It really just depends upon what type of service organization you are. But what we're trying to do is reduce overall costs, increase responsiveness to customers, and make sure that you have materials where you need them, when you need them. Now, they have an example in the book about a publishing model. The one that they give you is really an antiquated model. It doesn't really fit anymore. So I gave you kind of a newer one based upon personal experience and what it actually looks like these days. So as an author, let's say you're going to build a book and we're trying to, for example, look at a supply chain for that. Well, really, the author is the first one who makes the creation, author or authors. We call it literary creation. It could be a music creation, whatever that is. Now, it used to be that then the author would take their manuscript, goes to a publisher, then the publisher deals with it and does the promotions, and then goes to retailers and all that. That still happens, but it's not as prevalent. Most people now can't get started that way because a lot of publishers won't take them on. So what often happens is the author then is the first leg of promotion as well. So you actually have to guide this whole process as an author now. So if you get a publisher who really wants to promote you and stuff like that, where they'd even give you an advance to do it, you're really lucky. If not, you go through the route of self-publishing, or you can go to a producer, which is a publisher / producer, where they will do printings and things, but it's usually on your dime. So some people start out that way. There is editing services, printing, distribution, promotion, but again, all that costs money. And if you're willing to do it yourself, great. But otherwise, it'd be great if there was a publisher willing to take that risk. And then there's the retailer. Now, do you actually go to a retailer like a Barnes & Noble? Not always. Sometimes now they're just selling books straight online, straight to the customer. So you see a lot of that has shifted, where there's still sales, distribution, and promotion going to the online world, which is, again, where a group like Amazon has really taken a big foothold. So supply chain management can vary, and this is just kind of a simplified version of supply chain management. But it is completely varied based upon the type of company. Now, the global marketplace has a couple aspects that we have to think about when we think of a global marketplace. It's really a trend in business that focuses on customers, suppliers, and competitors globally. So you don't just think about, okay, I'm going to take this local market and then I'm going to saturate that and then start going to the next market and the next market. A lot of companies, with the advent of the internet, can now take place of or take advantages of a global marketplace. So what is operation management? What's their role in this? Well, you got to look. Say, okay, we may have this product that works in this space for, let's say, in the United States, in Ohio, but maybe it doesn't work so well in Scandinavia, or maybe it doesn't work so well in Australia or China or wherever else you're trying to look. You also then have to decide if you're going to sell in other locations like that. Are you going to locate facilities there to manage the flow? Or make it more direct to where the customers are at? How are you going to manage your suppliers? How do you want to meet local government standards? Who are you going to talk to? And maybe there's a language barrier and you have to deal with that. There's the North American Free Trade Agreement, which is kind of up in arms now and being renegotiated by the current administration. So how's that going to affect things when those trade agreements shift? How does the European Union work when we've got different countries leaving the European Union? So we have Brexit, so that changes things. If you're going to trade within Britain versus everywhere else in the EU, how do you interact with the World Trade Organization that kind of sets up some standards for those types of things? So all those things are important to realize. Also, sustainability and green operations is really another thing that has come online. So in other words, when we discuss sustainability, it's really a trend in business to consciously reduce waste in our production. How do we recycle what we can? How do we reuse what we can in products and parts? The ISO 14000 is a way to try to address some of these things. So again, it's an international standards organization that says this is kind of what we should be doing to promote sustainability. So they look at, from the environmental responsible standpoint and set up what should be the standards that companies go by. So a lot of companies spend quite a bit of time and money figuring out how they can better do this, and then how they can make it cost effective as well. Also, electronic commerce has affected us greatly, and there are several types. I mean, it's the same types as if it was direct commerce, but in electric commerce, we have business to business or B2B, business to customers, B2C, or customer to customer, C2C. In each one of those situations, the way you design your commerce between those parties matters. So if you have something that's business to customers, well, you may just have a website and a cart like you typically have where you can buy things directly online. But if you're customer to customer, now you're setting up a marketplace between two parties. That's quite a bit different. Or business to business. Maybe you don't have anything where it's like a cart like that, and it's actually because it's probably higher dollar costs, you're going to actually have intermediaries, and really electronic commerce is really websites, or maybe you set up transactions, things like that. Lots of different scenarios, and this is really kind of the cusp of where a lot of business is now. The other type of trend that we've seen is a lot of outsourcing. Now, outsourcing changes back and forth. So over the trend from, as you can see here, from 96 all the way through 2012, outsourcing rose and rose. However, there eventually started to end up being costs for outsourcing, such as IP being stolen, such as less control of what happens in those other countries, because maybe the politics may be toxic. Who knows? There could be lots of things there. So the trends are shifted a little bit. Doesn't mean they've gone away, because some things, it's just so much cheaper to make certain products or goods in certain countries versus the United States. But it's something to keep in mind. It changes. So right now we have tariffs and a tariff war going on between the United States and China. So that has an effect on, do I make my goods in China and try to bring them back to the United States? Well, if it's 25-35%, who knows? I mean, it's all kind of up in the air at this point, at the time I'm recording this. Maybe not, because maybe that you can make up that 25% by producing at home, and now it's closer and you don't have to do the shipping. So there's all sorts of factors to look at that. The other thing that's really affecting a lot of businesses today is big data analytics. So really kind of a working definition that we can use from our perspective is applying mathematics and statistics to huge, I mean, I say large volumes, but it can be huge volumes of structured and unstructured data. Some of it public, some of it private, depending upon if you're buying data from, say, a Facebook or Google or something like that. And they're getting lots of business insights from those types of things. Data comes in all forms. It could also be your own data. I should add that as well. So you could be getting data from the point of sale. That maybe that's on your website, or maybe it's a service slash hardware that you use at your retail store. RFIDs, this is a way to locate goods. GPSs, where are things being bought? Where is things being transported to? Twitter feeds, Facebook, call centers, blogs, all sorts of interesting things. Okay, so let's reel it back in a little bit and look at the environment for OM today. So customers do demand better quality and greater speed at lower costs, and that's constantly a pressure. That pressure has never gone away. So how do companies respond? Well, they try to implement something like a lean system concepts. We're going to talk about this more later on in the class, so I'm just introducing it right now, and a total systems approach to efficient operations. We need to recognize the need to better manage our information. So what you see in almost any company now is at least a CRM system, which is a customer a relationship management system, all the way to a full-fledged ERP, which is an enterprise management system. So we'll look at the different scales of those things in between, because depending upon whether you're a startup, you can't afford a full-fledged ERM, all the way to a large company, the types of choices and things that you make matter, because you have different amounts that you can pay for such those things. So a lot of these things are cross-functional decisions. So an operations manager does not make decisions in a vacuum, because you usually are interfacing with the CEO, you're interfacing with marketing and finance, because all those factors come in. So it's probably the most diverse organizational function when you think about it, because you got to talk to everybody else. You're managing the magic. This is where the magic happens. It's the transformation process of what comes into the company and what comes out of the company. It has many faces. You could be a VP, you could be at a director level, manager level, plant manager level, quality specialist. All of these things are part of operations. Or you could be the executive level. All business functions need information from OM in order to work. So here's just kind of one diagram that they have from the book, where maybe you have a VP of operations, and for marketing, you have to have an ability to meet what their sales and what their demand think, that what they think is going to be coming from the customers. So you need to develop operations that can meet those demands. From the finance side, you're going to have needs from finance, say, look, we need this capital so we can build these systems. And so that's the interactions you might have there. What the financial status is, and always in concert with the president or CEO. Other types of relationships that also are there, there's pathways between marketing on what's actually being communicated. So operations management probably has to give what's our capacity, what can we make, what's our levels of inventory, how fast can we produce more. Coming back from marketing would be customer demands, customer feedback, need for new products. For your information systems, what is the information need you have going to the middle? And they can say, what is your technology capabilities? Finance, again, we've talked about that, investments versus budgets and what you need. Engineering, there's constantly going between products, trade-offs, design requirements, those things. Accounting and finance, those probably should be a little bit more tied together. Finance is longer. Projecting accounting as day-to-day, and human resources, because now you need people to do these transformations. So what are your labor requirements? You have to let them know. So business information constantly flows. So really, thank you. That's it for today, and I will see you in class. Take care.